This video is the first of a series on spherical trigonometry, and ultimately it's used for global navigation. In this video, I want to introduce some of the basic concepts and derive two very important properties, the spherical version of the law of cosines and law of sines. But first, some basics. We can start by thinking back to plane geometry. Given two points, there was exactly one line going between them, and the shortest distance between these points was the segment of the line joining them. We could intersect two non-parallel lines in a single point, and given three non-collinear points, the line segments joining them formed a planar triangle. Now we wish to change the base upon which we construct our geometry from a plane to a sphere. The entity that replaces our line is that of a great circle. This can be defined as the intersection of a plane with a sphere, where the plane contains the center of the sphere, or equivalently, a circle on a sphere whose center is the center of the sphere. Note that if we have two points on a sphere, there is just one great circle going through both, and the shortest path between the two points will be an arc of a great circle. In spherical trig, we have no parallel lines. All non-coincident great circles will intersect in two diametrically opposite or antipodal points on the sphere. A portion of a sphere bounded by two great circles is called a lune. This is the same name astronomers use to refer to the lighted portion of the moon visible from the Earth. A portion of a sphere bounded by three great circles is called a spherical triangle. We will only be working with spherical triangles where each interior angle is less than 180 degrees. Like planar triangles, a spherical triangle has six parts, three angles and three vertices. The key difference is that all six parts for a spherical triangle are given an angular measure. These sides are all segments of great circles. They're measured by the angle between the two lines joining the endpoints to the center of the arc. That is, they're measured the same as the angle associated with the planar arcs in the plane containing the spherical side. The angles at the vertices are measured as the angle between the tangents to the side arcs, which meet at the vertex. These two tangents lie in the plane tangent to the sphere at the vertex. Another way to think of this angle is that it's the angle between the two planes corresponding to the two side arcs. This is called the dihedral angle. Note that a spherical triangle does not have a length associated with it, only arc measures. So for instance, all of the spherical triangles shown here are the same. This means that all properties we derive for spherical triangles are independent of the size of the sphere. When we do choose a specific radius for our sphere, we can find the measure of any particular side using our plane formula, S equals R times theta, where theta is given in radians. The two spheres we will be discussing the most are the unit sphere and the sphere corresponding to the planet Earth, which is typically called the terrestrial sphere. A unit sphere is a sphere of radius 1, so every great circle is a unit circle, and the length of each side of a triangle is exactly the same as the angle which defines it, assuming we're using radians to measure all the angles. When we use the terrestrial sphere as a model, we will typically use degrees or degrees, minutes, seconds to measure our angles. The length of each spherical side is easy to compute using nautical miles for length because 1 degree of arc equals 60 nautical miles, or 1 nautical mile equals 1 minute of arc. Now we're ready to derive our first theorem, the spherical law of cosines. There is, of course, a law of cosines for planar triangles, and we're going to use that to derive our new version. We'll assume for now that we are dealing with a unit sphere, so our sides are all arcs from a unit circle. Consider the projection of a side onto a plane tangent to the sphere at one vertex. In the plane containing the side arc, we have the image shown above. Now, since d1 over 1 equals the tangent of our angle alpha, we have that the top line has a length tangent alpha. Similarly, 1 over d2 equals the cosine, so taking the reciprocal, d2 equals the secant of alpha. So now create a tangent plane at vertex A of a triangle on a unit sphere and project sides little b and c onto this plane. We'll also create a line segment joining the projection of vertices capital B and C on the tangent plane, shown here in orange. We now want to compute the square of the length of this new segment using two different triangles and the planar law of cosines. From the triangle on the tangent plane with sides tan B and tan C and included angle capital A, we get L squared equals tan squared B plus tan squared C minus 2 tan B tan C cosine capital A. Similarly, using the triangle with sides secant B and secant C and included angle small a, We get that L squared equals secant squared b plus secant squared c minus 2 secant b secant c cosine of little a. Setting these equal, we can subtract secant squared from both sides. Recall that tangent squared minus secant squared equals negative 1. So we have negative 2 secant b secant c cosine little a equals negative 2 minus 2 tan b tan c cosine capital A. Now divide everything by negative 2 secant b secant c and change everything to sine and cosine and simplify, and we're left with cosine little a equals cosine b cosine c plus sine b sine c times cosine capital A. This is one of the three versions of the law of cosines. The other two would follow by just moving the tangent plane to vertex b or c. Notice these same parts are being related here as with the planar law of cosines. If we know all the parts at a particular vertex, then we can find the opposite side. Similarly, if we know the three sides, then we can find any one of the vertex angle values. The versions for vertex B and C are shown here also. Consider solving the spherical triangle shown here. This is a side angle side case, since we know two sides and the included angle. Because we know all the information at vertex capital A, we can use the law of cosines to find side small a. Plugging these into our first version, we get cosine little a equals cosine 50 cosine 40 plus sine 50 sine 40 cosine 30. Evaluating all these, we get cosine little a equals 0.9188, hence a equals the inverse cosine, which is about 23.24 degrees. Now we have three sides, so we can use these second and third versions of the law of cosines to find angles capital B and capital C. Using the second version, starting with side little b, we get cosine 50 equals cosine 23.24 times cosine 40 plus sine 23.24 times sine 40 times cosine capital B. Solving for cosine capital B and evaluating, we get cosine capital B equals negative 0.240899. Hence, vertex B equals the cosine inverse, or about 103.93 degrees. Similarly, using the third version, starting with side C, we get cosine 40 equals cosine 23.24 times cosine 50 plus sine 23.24 sine 50 times cosine capital C. So solving for cosine capital C, we get cosine C equals 0.57657, and finally vertex C equals 54.79 degrees. A special case of the law of cosine occurs when one of the vertex angles is 90. Consider our third version, starting with cosine little c, and assume that capital C is 90 degrees. Then cosine capital C equals cosine 90 equals 0. So we're left with cosine little c equals cosine little a times cosine little b. This is a spherical version of the Pythagorean theorem. Of course, if capital A equals 90 degrees, then cosine little a equals cosine b times cosine c, and if capital B equals 90, then cosine little b equals cosine a times cosine c. Remember that a spherical triangle can have more than one 90 degree angle. In fact, they could all three be 90 degrees. Now for the law of sines. We'll again use our spherical law of cosines to help us derive the spherical law of sines. Let's start with the first version of our law of cosines, and this time we solve for cosine capital A. We now plug the right-hand side into our standard trig identity, sine squared A equals 1 minus cosine squared A. Next, get a common denominator and replace sine squared little b and sine squared little c with 1 minus cosine squared. Multiplying this out, combine like terms. Now take the square root of both sides and finally divide both sides by sine little a. We have sine capital A over sine little a equals some ugly fraction. But notice on the right-hand side, the sides small a, b, and c can all be rearranged without changing the value. Our choice of the first version of the law of cosines was arbitrary, and if we use the second version and apply the same logic, you can see that we get sine capital B over sine little b equals the exact same fraction. Likewise, using the third version of the law of cosines, we can show that sine capital C over sine little c is also equal to this fraction. Hence, these three ratios are all equal, and we get the spherical law of sines, sine capital A over sine little a equals sine capital B over sine little b equals sine capital C over sine little c. And of course, we can flip all these over if we prefer to have these small angles on the top. It's impressive how closely this resembles our planar law of sines. In order to use it, we will again have to have at least one side an opposite angle to find the common ratio. Once we have that ratio, we can use it to find an angle opposite a known side or a side opposite a known angle. Consider this angle-angle side case. Because we have an angle on the opposite side, in this case, little a and big A, we can find the ratio needed for the law of sines. Now we can use the fact that we know angle B equals 45 degrees to find the measure of side little b. Plugging these in, we get the sine little b over sine 45 equals sine 70 over sine 90. This gives us sine little b equals 0.66446. So b equals the inverse sine, which is 41.64 degrees. Now, since angle A is 90 degrees, we can use the spherical Pythagorean theorem. We know cosine little a equals cosine little b times cosine little c, since a is our right angle. Hence, cosine of 70 equals cosine 41.64 times the cosine of little c. So cosine little c equals 0.45765, and finally c equals the inverse cosine, or approximately 62.76 degrees. And finally, now we have side little c. We can again use our law of sines ratio to find angle big C. We have sine capital C over sine 62.76 equals sine 90 over sine 70. This gives us sine capital C equals 0.94615, hence C equals approximately 71.11 degrees. Note, we also had three sides here, so we could have also used our law of cosines to find the measure of C. You can see here that the result is the same. The law of sines is generally quicker and easier, but we do have to be careful about getting a reference angle value from the inverse sine if our angle is more than 90 degrees. If you suspect you might have an obtuse angle, it's usually safer to use the law of cosines. The law of sines also gives us a quick way to check our triangle. Simply check all three ratios and verify they match. This helps increase our level of confidence, as well as ensuring we have a valid triangle. So that should be enough to get you started with spherical triangles. The spherical law of cosines, law of sines, and Pythagorean theorem are the most fundamental properties, and by far the most useful. In my next video, I plan to discuss polar triangles, which will allow us to solve some of the other spherical triangle cases we currently still cannot solve. I hope you found this video helpful. You can see more of my math videos at www.mathforeveryone.info. Please feel free to leave comments and suggestions, and thanks.